Hello students, today we are going to learn a very important technique which is important during green revolution, and it is plant breeding. We try to understand what is the plant breeding. So plant breeding is the purposeful manipulation of a plant species in order to create desired plant type. Okay, that are better suited for the cultivation, and even our main focus is to give a better yield. Okay, and that must be a disease resistance. So this is our main intention after a plant breeding. So conventional plant breeding has been practiced for thousands of years. Okay, from past we are doing these methods since the beginning of human civilization. Okay, recorded evidence of plant breeding date back is a 9,000-11,000 year ago. So from the these much year back we are doing this. Okay, many present day crops are the result of domesticated in ancient time. Many present day crops which we are using today are the result of domestication in an ancient time. Okay, and today all our major food crops are derived from domesticated variety. Classical plant breeding involves crossing or hybridization of a pure line. Now you know very well what is a pure line, that is a homozygous dominant line. Okay, followed by artificial selection to produce plant with desirable traits or higher yield, nutrition and resistance to disease. Okay, that is a classical plant breeding. With advancement in a genetics, day by day we are growing more and more in the field of genetics, okay, molecular biology, tissue culture, plant breeding methods. Okay, and now we are increasingly being carried out by using molecular genetical tool also. So now we are very much rich in these sciences. So now by using this diagram, let me try to understand what is a conventional breeding and what is a genetical modification. So first of all, here you can see two different plants are there. One is having a virus resistance plant and one is having a high yielding plant, and you want to combine both the characteristic in a single plant. Then what happens? Male gamete and female gamete will be collected. Okay, then fertilization occur artificially and you will get a virus resistance and high yield grow in a single organism. Okay, whereas in genetical modification, gametes are not considered. The gene from the virus resistance plant is taken out, then high resistance, high yield crop plant also we are taking out the gene from that, and then we will combine this gene in the laboratory and then we insert this gene into one organism, and by this we will get a virus resistance and high yield crop. This is the difference between this genetical modification type of breeding and conventional breeding. If we were to list the traits or characteristic that the breeders have tried to incorporate into crop plants, the first we would list would be increased crop yield. Mainly we are focused on increased crop yield and improved quality. Okay, and increased tolerance to environmental stresses also, that is a salinity, extreme temperature, drought resistance. Okay, we are more focused on this. Then resistance to pathogen, that is also our main goal. It must be resistance to pathogen like viruses, fungus and bacteria. And third, our approach may be increased tolerance to insect pests. So these are all are the main vision, or we can say main aims during our plant breeding techniques. Plant breeding programs are carried out in the systematic way worldwide, whether it is governmental institute or commercial companies. Okay, the main step in a breeding a new genetical variety of crop plants are as follow. So first step in any breeding process is a collection of a variability. Okay, so let me try to understand what is this step. Genetical variability is the root of any breeding program. Okay, genetical variety is the root of any breeding program. This is a very important step. In many crops, the pre-existing genetical variability is available from wild relative of the crops. Okay, and collection and preservation of all the different wild varieties, species and relative of the cultivated species, followed by their evaluation for their characteristics. Sometime that must be evaluated. Otherwise, nobody will get the idea which type of characteristic they will express. That's why this is very important step to evaluate the characteristic. Is a prerequisite for the effective exploitation of a natural gene available in the population. Otherwise, we cannot get the idea which type of gene will express in the offsprings. The entire collection of a plant, or maybe it may be seeds, having all the diverse alleles, Okay, means entire collection, whether it is plant is collected or a seeds collected. Okay, entire collection having all the diverse alleles, means all type of expression having the gene. Okay, a diverse allele for all gene in a given crop is called germplasm collection. And sometime banks for that is also maintained, and that is called germplasm banks. Second step is evaluation and selection of parents. Okay, first step was a collection of a variability, and now second is the evaluation and selection of a parents. The germplasm is evaluated so as to identify plant with the desirable combination of character. Out of all the genetical variety, we have to identify the desirable combination or character. The selected plants are multiplied and used in the process of hybridization. Then selected plant will be used for further processes. Pure line are created whenever or wherever desirable and possible. Okay, here you can see varieties are collected. Okay, but out of these two, out of these four, you can see only two will be selected because this is the homozygous pure line. Okay, so homozygous is only collected in this step. Okay, so this will be deselected. Okay, this will be avoided. Heterozygous will be avoided. Third step, and that is cross hybridization among the selected parents. After the selection of parents, cross hybridization step is followed. The desired character have very often to be combined from two different plants, okay, or parents. For example, high protein quality of one parent may need to be combined with disease resistance from another parent. So one will have a high quality protein, okay, and another will have disease resistance. So these two character we want to recollect. This is possible by cross hybridization only, in which the two parents to produce hybrid that genetically combine the desired character in a one single plant. This is a very time consuming process, okay, tedious process, and since the pollen grain from the desirable plant chosen as a male parent, okay, and have to be collected and placed on the stigma, that is artificial hybridization method of the flower, and selected as a female parents. Mostly we are talking about plants, and that's why here to select the male parent and female parent. Also, it is not necessary that the hybrid do combine the desirable character only. It is not compulsory that if you are collecting the character, then it may be possible that undesirable also collected. Here you can see undesirable also may collected. Okay, so also it is not necessary that the hybrid do combine the desirable character only. Usually only one in a few hundred to a thousand crosses show the desirable combination. So many numbers are there, and out of there only few numbers you will found which having a desirable character. Okay, so here you can see a cross hybridization. What is the meaning of cross hybridization? Here you can see the example. Okay, this is a red flower plant, this is a yellow flower plant, and then you do the cross pollination or a cross hybridization. As a result of that, you will found a different color, that is having a blue, a red color also and yellow color also. Similarly, you may mix the color also. Okay, here parent A is there, parent B is there. Okay, parent A having a red color flower, then parent B have a yellow color flower, and offspring will have mix of
color. Fourth
step is a selection and a testing of superior recombinants. Okay, so let me try to understand. This step consists of selecting among the progeny of the hybrid. Here you can see this is the parent generation, and this is F1 generation, and this is the progeny. Okay, so out of these all progeny, some will be selected which are the superior. Okay, and some will be rejected which are not desirable. Okay, so here is we can see this is selected, this is avoided, this is avoided. Okay, so by this way, these step consist of selecting among the progeny of the hybrids. Not all the hybrids will be taken out. Okay, it will be selected. Those plants that have the desired character combination, means only it is be selected which have a desirable characters. The selection process is a crucial to the success of the breeding objective. Okay, this is very important step. Otherwise, if you fail in this step, then all process will be failed. The selection process is a crucial to the success of the breeding objective and requires careful scientific evaluation of the progeny. Okay, and this is very important step. This step is plant that are superior to both of the parents. Very often more than one superior progeny plant may become available. It is sometime it is also there plant may be available. These are self-pollinated for several generations till they reach a state of uniformity. Okay, the self-pollination is done till they reach to the state of homogeneity, or we can say uniformity, so that the character will not segregate in the progeny, and then only it will be selected. Final and the fifth step is a testing, release and commercialization of new cultivars. Okay, so the new selected lines are evaluated for their yield and another agronomical traits of the quality, disease resistance. This all must be evaluated, and after that only you can release in the market. Okay, this evaluation is done by the growing these in the research field. First of all, these cultivar must be grown in the research field, and we have to record their performance or results under the ideal fertilization application, irrigation. These all parameters must be ideal, and other crop management practices. Okay, the evaluation in research field is followed by testing the materials in the farmer's field for at least 3 growing seasons. This is compulsory. Okay, you have to cultivate these all cultivars for at least 3 growing seasons at several locations, not in a single location. You have to cultivate in different locations of the country before releasing the market. So, location in the country representing all the agroclimatic zones where the crop is usually grown. The material is evaluated in comparison to at least available local crop cultivars. Okay, and it is taken as a reference cultivar or a check cultivar. Now, let me try to understand by using this diagram. What is done? Testing in research field. Research field will be selected. Okay, for 3 growing season, you have to cultivate that in the research field. And this research field must be selected from all over the country, from different zones, agroclimatic zones. And you have to cultivate these for at least 3 growing seasons. And after that only, if this product means or cultivate it found to be a very good cultivar, then only you have to release it in the market. All of you know very well that India is mainly an agricultural country. Okay, agriculture account for approximately 33% of India's GDP and employs nearly 62% of population. And after India's independence, we know one of the main challenges facing the country was that producing enough food for the increasing population. And you know very well, India is growing day by day in the population. As only a limited land is fit for cultivation, India has to strive to increase yield per unit area. Okay, we cannot increase the field. Okay, we can increase the yield. So here it is written, India has to strive to increase the yield per unit area from existing farm lands. The development of several high yielding variety of wheat and rice in the mid 1960s as a result of various plant breeding techniques led to dramatic increase in fruit production in our country. Okay, during 1960s. This phase is often referred to as a green revolution. So at that time, the green revolution, traditional farming can only yield a limited biomass as a food for humans and the animals. Better management practice can increase the yield, but only to a limited extent. Whereas the plant breeding as a technology has helped to increase yield to a very large extent. And that's why we can say that plant breeding technique is a boon in agricultural fields. Green revolution was dependent to a large extent on the plant breeding techniques for development of high yielding and disease resistance variety in the wheat and rice and also in the maize. The person whose contribution in a green revolution is very important was Dr. Norman Barlow. Okay, and Dr. Norman Barlow was the American agricultural scientist and a plant pathologist and winner of the Nobel Prize for the Peace in 1970. He was one of those who laid a groundwork of the so-called Green Revolution and the agricultural technological advances that promised to alleviate world's hunger. Now, let me go through some important crops which are developed during Green Revolution as a part of a Green Revolution. So, during the period 1960 to 2000, wheat production increased from 11 million tons to 75 million tons. Okay, while rice production went up from 75 million tons to 89.5 million tons. This is a drastic change. Okay, this was due to development of semi-dwarf variety of wheat and rice. A Nobel laureate, Normal Ibalo, at International Center for Wheat and Maize Improvement, that is also called ICWMI, at the Mexico, developed a semi-dwarf wheat. Okay, in 1963, several varieties of wheat, such as Sonalika, Kalyan Sona, which were high yielding and disease resistance, were introduced all over the wheat growing belt of India. Okay, so this is the Sonalika and Kalyan Sona variety. Semi-dwarf rice varieties were derived from IR8, that is developed in International Rice Research Institute, IRRI, Philippines, and Taichung Native 1 from Taiwan. Okay, the derivatives were introduced in 1966. Later, better yielding semi-dwarf variety like Jaya and Ratna, that is also variety of rice, were developed in India. After wheat and rice, third crop is the sugar cane. So here you can see Saccharum barberi, that is a scientific name for a sugar cane. It is one variety of a sugar cane, was originally grown in North India but had a poor sugar content and yield. Tropical canes grown in South India like a Saccharum officinarum, that is another variety of a sugar cane, had a thicker stem and higher sugar content but did not grow well in North India. Okay, these two species were successfully crossed to get sugarcane variety combining the desirable qualities of high yield, thick stem, high sugar and ability to grow in sugarcane in areas of North India. So by this way, after recombination, we can get this type of variety. Next crop is a millet. It is including maize, jowar, bajra, have been successfully developed in India. Hybrid breeding have led to the development of several high yielding variety and resistance to water stress. Before we finish the lecture, let me go through an animation video to summarize the topic. So look at this video.
India is an agricultural country with 62% of people engaged in agriculture for their livelihood. With the passage of time and an increase in population, the demand for food has risen extensively. Earlier, this was tackled through traditional farming and better management practices. However, it resulted in a very small increase in yield. It was only during the 1960s that the Green Revolution brought about a drastic increase in the production of high-yielding, disease-resistant crops like wheat and rice, by employing plant breeding techniques. Plant breeding involves crossing between plants with desired characters to produce offspring that possess the superior characters of both their parents. It dates back 9,000 to 11,000 years ago, when conventional plant breeding was practiced. Conventional or traditional breeding is crossing plants for desirable characters sexually through self or cross-pollination or asexually through grafting. Most of the major crops such as wheat, rice, and maize are the result of conventional breeding. On the other hand, classical breeding uses techniques such as mutation or tissue culture, followed by crossbreeding of pure lines and artificial selection of plants. The desirable characters of plants generated by plant breeding include high yield with quality, tolerance to different types of environmental stress, resistance to microbes and pests. Plant breeding is commonly carried out in government research institutes and some private organizations and involves several steps. The first step in plant breeding is the collection of germplasm of a particular crop that is intended for breeding. Germplasm is the collection of all the genes of different varieties of a particular crop in the form of seeds or plants. In this way, the naturally available gene pool can be utilized for breeding. The second step is the selection of superior parents. Here, two plants with the different desired characters are selected from the available germplasm. Then, they are made to self-cross to get a pure line of those varieties. The third step is cross-hybridization of the superior parents. This is done by collecting the pollen grains of one parent plant and placing them on the stigma of the other parent plant. However, the hybrids obtained may not contain all the desired characters present in the superior parents. In fact, 1 in 1,000 or 2,000 hybrids obtained may contain the desired characters of both superior parents. Hence, this step is considered cumbersome. The fourth step is the selection of superior hybrids. The desired hybrid is selected from the thousands of hybrids formed during crossbreeding that possess the characters of both its parents. Hence, it is considered superior than its parents. The hybrid is then allowed to self-pollinate till it forms a pure line of homozygous plants. The final step is the evaluation of the hybrid for the characters gained. This is done by first cultivating the hybrid in a research field under ideal conditions. Later, they are cultivated in farmers' fields at different locations for three growing seasons. This helps in comparing the performance of the hybrid against the best crop cultivar available in that area. In this way, plant breeding has increased the yield of many crops, including wheat, rice, sugarcane, and millet. The Green Revolution is a result of using various plant breeding techniques to boost agriculture. During this period, there was a dramatic increase in the production of wheat from 11 to 75 million tons and rice from 35 to 89.5 million tons. The increase in production was credited to the semi-dwarf varieties of wheat and rice that were developed. The semi-dwarf wheat variety was first developed at the International Center for Wheat and Maize Improvement in Mexico by Nobel laureate Norman E. Borlaug. Likewise, the semi-dwarf rice variety, IR8, was developed at the International Rice Research Institute, IRRI, in the Philippines. Later, better yielding varieties of wheat hybrids such as Sonalika and Kalyan Sona and rice hybrids such as Jaya and Ratna were developed in India. In the case of sugarcane, Saccharum barberi and Saccharum officinarum were crossbred to get a hybrid. The hybrid obtained had both the characters of its parents, such as a very thick stem with higher sugar content, and the ability to grow in northern parts of India. Similarly, high-yielding hybrids of millet, such as Jowar and Bajra, which are resistant to water scarcity, were also developed in India. In this manner, through various plant breeding techniques, many high-yielding crops were developed that helped boost Indian agriculture.
In next lecture, we will learn two topics, a plant breeding for disease resistance and plant breeding for developing resistance to insect pest. So till that, goodbye.